Good morning, everybody.
Good
and yeah,
morning, Victor.
And yeah, to emphasize Joe's notes, please, if you have a phone with Wi-Fi, would you please shut it off? We need the bandwidth to run service here this morning. With that being said, good morning, everybody. How about we get ready to worship, huh?
Want to all stand up if you're able, and let's
stand
worship
up.
God. Amen. We can even dance. If you want to dance in the aisles, whatever works.
There is a river where goodness flows. There is a fountain. Drown sorrow, there is an ocean deeper than fear. The tide is rising, rising. There is a current stirring deep inside. It's overflowing from the heart of God. The blood of heaven crashing over us. The tide is rising, rising.
Come on!
Come alive in the river.
Good morning, everybody. You can sit down if you want to, or if you feel like you can stand up. This is just church, and we're just worship here. You can do whatever it is as long as you're in the presence of the Lord. Anyways, my name is Victor, and I am the worship leader here at Just Church. And
sometimes.
All right. Woo! All right. Cool. Thanks, guys. Nice. And I'll be happy to do the announcements this morning. I know. I figure I stay here so you guys recognize me because I got the guitar on me. So, y'all, everybody's safe. Everything's cool. All right. Announcements. Celebrate Recovery, September 26th. Is that what it is? Tuesday nights is the best place to be. Amen. Tuesday nights. Sorry, guys. Bear with me. Student Ministry, Just Students, September 28th.
Woo!
Yeehaw.
Yeah.
I don't have it memorized. So Just Students, Thursday evenings at Newton Community Hall, 29 West Main Street, 6 to 8 youth, 12 plus are invited to come and have fun and learn practical spiritual principles and develop peer-mentor relationships to grow and progress into outstanding citizen in the kingdom of God.
I think Victor needs to go.
And now we're tagging in to Miss Alexis. She's got an announcement for us as well.
So my name is Alexis, if anybody doesn't know me. I run the kids ministry here, so we just wanted to plug in that we're looking for volunteers for both kids and nursery. Nursery, that being said, is actually closed right now until October because we have some busy events going on here at the church, so our leaders needed a little break, but they'll be back in October. Kids ministry is open today, so I'll be going in there with the kids after. If you're interested in doing anything, whether it be behind the scenes or teaching or even just being in there to help out and lend a hand and keep an eye on these kids while we teach them about Jesus, that'd be great. So contact me, or you can put it on the connection cards, which Jen's going to tell you about in a little bit.
All right. We also got men's breakfast. I think it's October 1st,
seventh.
Correct, Joe?
Seventh.
Or 7th? October 7th, men's breakfast at 9 a.m., correct? All right. So if you're a man, if you love Jesus, we're going to be at the community center here, right across the street where we'll have breakfast, which, by the way, breakfast 9:30 every Sunday. You're more than welcome to join us. Amen? All right. With that being said, let's get on up and get back into worship. Let's pray to get us back into worship. God, thank you so much. I thank you because you bring us here this morning. I thank you because you are sovereign. And with that, I ask that you have mercy on us and fill us with your presence. Guide us on everything that we do in this ministry and in our lives. If there is anything that's not of you this morning, please let it fall away in Jesus' name. And bring us all to peace. Thank you.
shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, the silence fear. Oh, Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus. Ooh. Jesus, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus. Your name is a light that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is alive, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome.
Sing it again.
Your name is alive, but the shadows can't deny. Jesus, 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 Jesus,
amen, amen. Thank you, God, for your light. Thank you for making the darkness tremble and allowing us to come into your home, your house, and loving us with grace, grace that we do not deserve, but we are given freely from you. In the name of Jesus, amen. Journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is the canvas for your strength. My story isn't over, and my story's just begun. This failure won't define me, cause that's what my Father does. The failure won't define me, cause that's what my Father does. Ooh. Shame at the door, your spirit ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
not the end game. The journey's where you are. You never wanted perfect, you just wanted my heart. And the story isn't over, if the story isn't good. This failure's never final when the Father's in the room. Failure's never final when the Father's in the room.
Kids. They were so awkward. It was hilarious watching them. I'm Jen Makinich. I am the leader of Just Students Youth Group and the wife of this darling right here. So, my job today is connection card. You guys all have these in the front of the seats. We do a lot of things outside of these four walls at this church. It's really important if you guys are new here to put your information on here, especially your email address. Pastor John writes awesome emails twice a week to let us all know what's kind of going on so you can be part of stuff outside of here. I'm happy to see you. So just go ahead and fill that out. We're going to collect them with the offering later on today at the end of service. Also, on the back side, if you guys have any questions, concerns, those little check marks on here. Oh, I'm shaking. I'm a little nervous. I don't feel nervous, though, like... I need coffee. Maybe that's what it is. Okay. Thanks. I'm just going to steady me a little. I am all the time. Okay. This is really important because you guys can share your prayers, answered prayers on the back of it. I know we say it every week, but it doesn't get old because we get to get told what God is doing in your life. So we love you. We all are a family. So let us be there for all of you guys. If you guys have something going on, it's private. Only the leaders will read about it, and we will be praying for you. It's not like a empty prayer kind of card, okay? And here's my hubby, Pastor James.
Awesome.
I'm leaving.
What? Come stand next to me. Come on. No? You're just going to sit right there? I want to thank all the guys that were actually doing, Victor, Alexis, Jen. You guys did a great job. It's an awesome way to stand out. I always find it hilarious when you have musicians that actually have to talk. because they don't know how to do it. They are up there, they're like, hello, everyone. I am Victor, and I am the worship leader. It makes me laugh so hard. You guys always heckle me, so now I get to heckle a little bit back. That's right. Thank you. Thank you. So, welcome. Welcome to Just Church. Thank you guys all for being here. I am Pastor James. Now, this is a funny thing. I'm the only pastor in the house. Have you guys noticed the past couple weeks? It's been a little wild around here. That's because I've been in charge. But if you guys might be wondering where Pastor John and Rachel are actually, and it's actually a really, really cool thing. Don't do it yet. I knew you were going to do it. They had, well, Julia, they're had a baby. So this is their second grandchild, and his name is Theo. Theodore Elias Grew. Yeah, hey, why don't you come here? Come here. Come here. You introduce it.
Right after the instruments thing, you want me to talk? That's okay. That's Mitchell, and that's his newest son. That's Theodore Elias Grew. Yeah. Woo! Yeah. That's my second nephew now. That's Pastor Rachel, my mother, with Theodore Elias Grew. I don't know. That's the third time. I guess I'm going to keep introducing from now on. All right. But yeah, that's... What do we got? What do we got next? No more? Okay. Well, Pastor Rachel and Theodore Elias Grew, my newest nephew.
Great job, Elijah. Great job. So that's where they've been. And I believe, yes, they definitely will be here next week so you get to see them in person and congratulate them. But now let's actually, I'm going to pray and then I'll introduce you. Lord Jesus, I ask that you just be with Adrienne today as she gives her testimony. Lord God, allow us to focus. Allow us to take any type of whatever that's bouncing around our head and set it aside for about 20 to probably maybe half an hour. And then you can pick it up if you want to. But Lord, allow us to just know that you have something to say through Adrienne today. And allow us to pay attention to it. Lord God, we love you and we thank you. It's in your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen. So now I get to introduce Adrienne. And Adrienne has been how long have you been with Just Church? 3 years. That's amazing. So Adrienne is going to bring to you her test. I'm not messing with this. Is that okay? Because I don't want this thing to fall apart. I know that. All right, perfect. So, why don't everybody just give a big hand to Adrienne? Come on up.
Okay. Hi, I'm Adrienne. I'm a grateful believer in Jesus Christ. This is not something I would want to sign up to do, if I'm being honest, but Pastor Rachel taught me that the enemy is defeated by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. And I have found that to be very true in my life because the other people's testimonies saved my life. My story is definitely a death to life story. I grew up, I was born into a very loving and, great intentioned family that's plagued by the disease of addiction and other mental health disorders. We were taught, at a very young age always that, we look good on the outside no matter what. We got to make sure that, no one knows what's going on. And we, it wasn't a generation that really was encouraged to feel feelings or express feelings and things like that. So I, as far back as I can remember, I just was born this way. I think I just felt like this deep sense of shame about who I was as a person. I felt like an imposter in the world, not just like in my family, like in the world. I felt like if people really knew who I was, that they would leave me or they wouldn't like me. And that's just kind of how I came to the world. So the underlying theme of my life was shame. I just thought that I was broken. I thought I was an alien. I didn't think like other people. I didn't know how to keep up this facade like my family, you know, did. And I didn't really know how to keep my mouth shut and things like that. So, you know, I am the black sheep, and I'm proud of it today. But it's great. I love it now. Very freeing. But I hated it for a long time because I felt so isolated and so different, and I didn't know how to be honest with myself or anybody else. So that led to a life of disassociation and denial, basically. So that's how I lived. That's how I survived, and I didn't even know it. I just thought that that was normal. I also, you know, at a young age learned that the further up I could go in the ranks of society, you know, that's where my value would lie. So if I made more money, if I had that degree, if I had that job, if I got a promotion, it was like, okay, yeah, this is it. You know, and every time those things would happen, because that's what I would seek, I didn't feel any better. I'd feel good for like 5 seconds, you know, or I'd get like a high five from my dad, you know, and I'd be like, that's it. And truth be told, you know, my experience with addiction started off very slow, and I didn't really understand that I had the disease, because I thought that the disease of addiction was just like the person at the park, you know, with the paper bag. Like, I didn't understand that there's a lot more to it, as far as just my feelings about myself. Not being able to cope with life, being maladapted to life, is a term we use in recovery, and just feeling that immense sense of self-doubt and those deep, deep feelings of shame. I didn't understand that's like a big part of the disease, and it's not just about the drug or the drink. So I did spend years, you know, using anything I could to not feel those feelings or to fill a void. I call it now from recovery friends, a God-sized hole, you know, in my heart, in my soul, to try to make myself feel like I am lovable, worthy of, you know, other people's love or approval, like I'm part of. I wanted to belong so badly, and even when I was surrounded by people who were, quote, friends, I still just never felt like I truly belonged, like I truly was a part of a family, a community, anything. And I didn't know who I was. I didn't know, but so, you know, in my early 20s, one of my family members was really struggling with their addiction, and I was just dead set. I didn't understand addiction, dead set on saving them, and, you know, in the process, almost, you know, killed myself, and ended up in going to a program called Al-Anon. It's 12 steps for friends and families of alcoholics, and I've been going there for many years, and it really did help me in that relationship with that person, and it helped me start my spiritual journey. Because they follow the 12 steps. But when I first walked into Al-Anon, I was like, I read the 12 steps, and the second one says higher power. And because of my experiences as a child with God, the God that it was presented to me, I almost walked out. I was like, I am not doing this cult baloney. Like, I am not. They had, like, signs on the table of, like, all these quotes, and I was like, I'm not doing this. I'm all dressed to the nines, you know, planning my suicide. It's not funny, but it's kind of funny now. Like, I looked so put together, and inside I was completely dead. And on the verge of making some really scary decisions. And so the nice little old ladies in that room were just so gentle and kind, and it drew me to them. Their spiritual sort of peace kind of drew me in. So I kept going, and I was like, I'm just not going to do the God stuff until I did. So I end up getting a sponsor. It's a very long story. I won't get into the whole story, but she was like, into meditation, and she was very like open to any religion, any spirituality, and I would talk smack about Christianity, and Catholicism. Like, when I was growing up, they told me I was going to hell because whatever I did. And you know, the truth is, like, when I was like 12, I was like, well, I'm going to hell anyway, so who cares? You know, I have no respect for these people. I liked going to youth group because it was fun, but I always, even if it wasn't judgmental people I was around, I still felt when I walked into a church, like, oh, Lord, he's watching me, and he knows what's inside of me, like, whatever, you know, that guy in the sky watching me, keeping track of me. So it was not a good feeling. So I ended up starting to learn how to meditate and pray through this sponsor, but I felt zero connection with God, like, nothing. And I would do it every day, and I would complain to her, like, I still feel no change. I am still the same lunatic like I was yesterday, you know. So I also, you know, decided to get into a relationship with someone who struggled with addiction. And he, you know, would leave to go get drugs, and he'd, like, abruptly leave, and I'd chase him, or I'd follow him because I was afraid. Like, it was just like a whole codependent mess. And so my sponsor would say, get on your knees and pray instead of following him. And I was like, I can't do that. It's like, I had almost like a craving, I needed to follow him. Like, I was crawling out of my skin if I didn't. So one night, I ended up not following him, getting on my knees and doing what she told me to do. It was the most painful thing I can remember physically and emotionally doing. It felt like a withdrawal. And all of a sudden, I felt like a cool sensation come over my body. I was like, it was like I was looking down at myself, and I could see a man that looked like Jesus from my childhood, like, wrapping his arms around me, and I felt total peace. Like, all of a sudden, I went from complete and utter anxiety and withdrawal symptoms to complete peace. And I was, like, laying on the ground going, what is happening? But I knew it was something big. And so I went to bed that night, and I was never the same again. From that point on, when I prayed and meditated, I could feel a power greater than myself. I could feel what I now call the Holy Spirit. Just a calmness, a peace. Sometimes it does feel cool, like when we were just doing worship, I had goosebumps all over my body. And to me, that's my Holy Spirit. And so you would think that that experience would make me consider Jesus, but it didn't. It didn't. I did 10 more years with a higher power that I had no name for, which worked for me. Proof of how much, you know, God loves us. He didn't punish me for that. Like, God just kept loving me and trying to help me, trying to get me sober. And I just kept bulldozing through life with my own self-will. Praying sometimes, meditating sometimes, but drinking a lot more and more and more. So, you know, in the span of, I'd say, my late 20s to my early 30s, a lot of things happened kind of all at once. I watched someone I really love deteriorate and die, my mother. You know, I met someone and had a long relationship with him, married him. He had a brain injury that caused him to become violent and rageful, and we divorced. I dove into a relationship with someone. I started adopting two children. All the while, I'm drinking more and more. I had gotten that big promotion prior to this, and then, you know, the one I, like, always hoped for, and that was probably the most empty I ever felt in my life. I couldn't see what I couldn't see at the time, but I was slowly, spiritually and mentally, you know, kind of digging myself into a hole in the ground. Like, I was just giving up more and more and more of my values, giving up more and more and more of who I was. I wanted to be a good person. I cared deeply about people, but I hated them. Sorry, I did. I did not like people. I didn't want to be around people, even though I'm, like, such a people person, and that's what I do for a living. I have a lot of compassion to give, but I was losing all of it. I would continue to rely on relationships to fill that hole, that void. Anything, shopping, relationships, alcohol, hobbies, like anything to avoid feeling and to fill it. And it was just never full. So I, you know, lost my mom, lost my husband. One of my best friends kind of disappeared at the same time. And I kind of just dove into it. I was kind of done. So I tried to go, I knew subconsciously I think I needed help. So I would go to Al-Anon, I'd go to some open AA meetings. I'd stop drinking for a little while, but I wouldn't tell anybody about it. Because I was like, I'm not an alcoholic. This is just like a break to reset, you know, or I don't drink like him or her. I don't have that problem. Like, I promised myself as a kid I would not have that problem. I'm not going to carry on that legacy, you know. And I didn't understand until, you know, it happened to me and until I watched someone I loved die from it, that addiction truly is a disease. And it's not something people choose, and it can happen to anybody. So I, you know, ended up losing the two girls I was trying to adopt. The man that, the father of my son, at the last minute, he wasn't approved to be around them. And I had to choose between having him around his son in my home or adopting, you know, two girls and having a baby and doing it all completely by myself. And that was one of the toughest decisions I've ever had to make in my life. And I wouldn't wish that on anybody. It's definitely the biggest loss of my life to date. And when that happened, you know, the isolation was already there, and I was pregnant and I wasn't drinking, but I was losing it, because I couldn't drink and I didn't know how to feel anything. So I ended up, you know, staying in my bed for a week, staring at a wall, and then getting up one day and going to work like a robot and calling a close friend and saying what was going on and what I was thinking about, which was at that time taking my own life. And I had a very real plan, and I was ready. And she said, you know, I was very disassociated at the time, and she said, just drive to the nearest hospital. And I did, and it's not funny, but, you know, I was just so empty. I just told them, and, you know, then I'm like, why are they taking my stuff? Why are they putting me in a room and people are looking at me, you know, through a glass? I'm like, duh, I work in mental health, but I don't know. I was just very unwell at the time. But it was the best thing that could have happened to me at that moment. It was kind of like a turning point for me, in a way, because a social worker suggested I might have alcoholism and suggested I, you know, get to some AA meetings and get a therapist. And, you know, I got out and I went to a therapist or an AA meeting that night, and I went to a therapist. They wanted me to go to long-term treatment, and I should have, and I talked my way out of it because I know how to do that, but God stepped in and made it all right. So fast forward in the next few years, this is all across like the span of a decade, I had my son. I was, COVID hit. I was still trying to be sober for short periods, prove to myself that I'm not an alcoholic. I wasn't telling anybody I was doing that. Really going to open AA meetings saying I'm visiting from Al-Anon and, you know, underlining everything in the big book of Alcoholics Anonymous. You know, the lone wolf, being surrounded by people, having so many friends, but really never letting anyone past a certain point. All these things I could identify with, and I was, you know, I was kind of already, like, in that grave mentally and emotionally. Like, I felt so alone. I felt invisible. I felt like, this is it. Like, this is the grand finale. Everyone's going to see, you know, who I really am, and everyone's going to reject me. Yeah, that kind of thing. And, you know, unfortunately my son's father and I both suffered quite a bit from our own diseases, and he wasn't ready, you know, to get well, and so I made the decision that we needed to be apart and I was going to try to get well. I had a friend who passed away, who I had met when I was spying on AA, and I knew his mother very well, and that's Ray Ray, for those of you who know him. When Ray Ray died, I had said no to going to church many times, and I had said, I'm not an alcoholic, and at his, I called Diana, and I'm like, I want to bring you a baked ziti, because I'm dead inside, and that's all I know how to do to be emotionally supportive is cook, which is funny, but true. And she's like, you can bring it to celebrate recovery, which I had already said no. I didn't want to go there because it's Jesus. And, I even met a lady in a parking lot once who helped me, who I'm actually still in touch with. And she even had stopped to take the time to talk to me, and she ran a celebrate recovery. And I was like, what is this? But anyway, so we're still in touch. She's a wonderful lady. But I'm like, fine, I'll bring it to the celebrate recovery, like whatever. So I bring it. I'm like walking down the basement stairs, like trying to blend in. I'm invisible everywhere else in my life. I don't know why people are smiling at me and looking at me. I'm like, please stop. They turned off the lights and I felt a little better. They were playing worship music. It was Jerry and I don't remember who else, but it's something in the words. I think they played So Will I. And I can't remember the others, maybe Reckless Love. And the words just started to like penetrate my heart. Like I just started to feel tears, and I had been so numb for so long. I was kind of surprised. So I just sat there in support, but I started to definitely feel a change in my heart that night. And people weren't as scary as I thought. And then at his funeral, I stood in line at the wake with a lot of people from AA and listened to their chatter and could identify again with a lot of it. And then at his funeral, there were quite a few things said. Number one, we were in a church and they weren't condemning us, which I thought was shocking because I hadn't been in a church in a while. I had been to a funeral when I was a kid. My friend drowned, and the pastor told us if we don't stand up and get baptized in their church, their denomination, we were never going to see our friend again. And that was a resentment that took a long time for me to work through. But, that's not what I heard in just this service with some of the Just Church pastors. It was about love, unconditional love. It was about addiction. It was about recovery. And it was about Jesus, and I was shocked at how much it made sense to me and how much I could relate. But I still was like, okay, this has definitely got to be a cult. Like, they're too nice, you know. So then at the end, they read, no joke, like, I really did think it was a cult for, like, the first year and a half. yeah. Sometimes I still do. I'm just kidding. But I'm just kidding. But so I went to, oh yeah, so then they read something. Some of you might know Emily. I didn't know her yet, but she had written something about the disease of addiction that was read at the funeral. And it just hit me like it was just a moment of clarity for me. And it was, I knew, I have a disease. I knew I had the disease of addiction, alcoholism. And I knew that if I didn't start taking steps myself and fighting for myself, that I was going to die from it, whether by suicide or a slow deteriorative death. I had had my last drink a couple weeks prior, didn't know it was going to be my last drink. I was just on another, break. And I haven't drank since. So it was February 27th, 2020 was my last drink. And yeah. And so, COVID was tough. I did some virtual meetings. I had a kid that screamed around the clock. His dad was in and out and tried to help the best he could and did when he could. And it was just a lot to manage. I was, I was clinically depressed and struggling with being dry and feeling all these things come up. And thank God, I jumped on a CR meeting that was virtual. I was able to see church virtually and like spy on church a little before I actually came in, which was awesome. Or I don't think I would have ever come. I'm serious. Thank you for that, COVID. that was great, right? And then, you know, I forgot to mention this one little thing. A few days before Ray's funeral, before all of that, I remember laying on the floor in my bedroom just feeling completely, I was just dead. I couldn't even cry. I didn't feel much. I was a robot for quite a while. And I remember hitting a point of desperation and looking up at the ceiling and praying for the first time in a long time. And I don't even know where the words came from, but I was praying for people. I was like, God, please send me the people. And you got to remember at that time, I isolated. I didn't want people to see me. I didn't like people. I kept everyone at an arm's length. So I was like, why am I praying for this? This is not me. These words are not mine. And then when I knew, I kind of knew, like at Ray's funeral and stuff, I'm like, I think these might be the people. Like, I just kind of knew. And then I'm like, no, you're crazy, Adrienne. You're crazy. But you ended up being the people. So thank you, God. So long story short, my journey was very slow and progressive. I was very paranoid. but I ended up going to a CR convention in July 2021, I think, with some ladies. And, like, on the way down, I'm really bad at booking flights. Like, don't ever put me in charge of that. I've had 24-hour layovers. Like, don't put me in charge of it. And, like, really bad. I had a 6-hour layover, not as bad. And I'm like, my friend gave me a book to read, and I took it out and I started reading it, and I'm opening my phone because I want to make sure I have the right verse. I'm still wondering, like, is this the right decision? Am I going to get there? Is this going to be another cult thing? Are they going to, like, brand me? Is this the initiation process? Like, I'm going to Texas. So I was kind of freaking out, and I start reading this book, and it's talking about, it's written by a female pastor, and she talked about Mark 5:21-34 about the woman who was bleeding for 12 years, but she gave, like, the context behind it. And she talked about how, you know, that woman was bleeding for 12 years, so she was isolated to a room. You're not allowed to leave a room. She was probably experiencing the symptoms of depression, anxiety, the isolation that, you know, I had put myself in. And I could just identify as I was reading it, and then she ran out of the room, ran into the street to touch Jesus's cloak for a chance at being healed. And it was just someone she'd heard about. She'd never met this guy. She didn't really know who he was. The Bible wasn't written at that time. And the cloak, not only could she be, you know, put in jail for leaving her isolation, but she could have experienced, you know, punishment for touching that part of his cloak, which I never knew this part. Because it was a part, it was the lining that only the family was to touch. And instead of, you know, condemning her, Jesus called and turned and called her daughter. And he said, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease. And, you know, like, her courage to do that and her faith, like, it just really, I was, like, sobbing in the airport. I'm really bad at traveling, but yeah, would not recommend. So I, you know, it just hit me, and I was like, all right, maybe this Jesus guy, like, isn't that bad. Like, I, you know, growing up, I had such a horrible, I'd associated him with such horrible things. You know, so the next morning, I'm still kind of nervous, and we walk in, and there's a lady doing spoken word, and I'm like, oh, gosh, this weird stuff, like, these weird church people are doing, like, raps and stuff. And so I'm like, what is happening? And then I started to hear what she was saying, and I was like, what? It was like she was, like, telling my story, you know. Her name was Hosanna Wong, and it was called I Have a New Name. And she talked about the names that she called herself and the world, the names the world called her. And I could identify so much with that, you know, crazy, unwanted, unlovable, rejected, too much were some of my words. And she said, but God has something different to say. And she starts quoting the Bible, which, to be honest, at that point, I don't even think I'd opened. And she said, you know, John 15:15, he calls me friend. 1 Thessalonians 1:4, he calls me chosen. Ephesians 2:10, he calls me his workmanship, his art, handmade, purposed and fashioned for good things. 1 Corinthians 9:16, he calls my body a temple. He calls it the residence of the Holy Spirit. Acts 1:8, he calls me a messenger to the world. Galatians 3:26, he calls me his child. Romans 5:8, he calls me greatly loved. John 36, he calls me free, free indeed. 2 Corinthians 5:17, he calls me brand new. And I just remember standing there, and I think that was like the moment I opened my heart to God and to Jesus. Like the tears just came. My friend was standing next to me. She said, "Are you okay?" And I said, "I just can't believe this is my life." Like from where I was a year ago, laying on that floor, you know, staring at the ceiling, wanting to be dead, to learning that, like, I'm actually loved. You know, I'm actually, this is like a 2,000-year-old book. I'm going to give it a shot. And I did. And, you know, I opened my ears and I, you know, like took the cotton out of my ears and put it in my mouth and I listened that whole week and I just felt a huge shift in my heart. I gave things to God that week, you know, from my heart, from my spirit that I'd been holding on to for a long time. And I decided to really give this a shot. You know, so I came back different from that trip and it's not been easy. I get a lot of, for me, I'm a very visual person, so watching The Chosen and then reading the passages from the Bible that relate to that has helped me tremendously. I really appreciate the way that we, in this church, how we present the Bible, because they talk about the context at the time, historically, and they also talk about translation, so what it truly means, which has really opened my mind to, like, seeing it very differently than what I grew up with, which was, like, just reading it straight, and if you, I mean, like, pick it up and look at it, it's very confusing book, if you don't know what's going on. You know, so I started to really learn that, like, Jesus was just pure love, you know, is pure love, and how radical it was that he came to earth during a time that was barbaric. You know, it was not like it is today. I mean, we are pretty barbaric in a different way, but like at that time, it was like pretty cutthroat. The people were just used to violence and used to retaliation, eye for an eye. And this guy's like walking around, not fighting anybody, literally loving everyone, even the Pharisees, even, you know, the criminals, everyone. And it made me realize, you know, like maybe he could love me too. You know, from there, I read the Bible now. I read devotionals. I come to church. If I can't get here, I watch it online. I love learning more about God. I feel a freedom like I've never felt before. My higher power that I had all those years was definitely the God of my understanding, same God. I just wasn't opening to it. I wasn't considering how big and how vast and how loving this God could be. And you know, over the last 4 years of my life, it's been some of the most challenging years with being a single parent and navigating finances and school and my own mental health and sobriety and recovery. It has done nothing but help me on that journey, being able to wake up and be worried about something but be able to surrender it to God and, like, just take the next right step and trust that it's going to be okay. I have taken leaps, like, off of the edge of, or it feels like that to me, like, off of the edge of cliffs, like, moving. Like, I was basically handed this gorgeous home, and I was like, no, I shouldn't take it, like, because I want to punish myself. That's just my instinct still, you know, and pray about it, and no, I'm going to do it. It's scary, but I'm going to do it, and I love my home. Like, my son and I have a very safe, beautiful, quiet home and a great community, and we live right next door to some of our church friends, recovery friends now. Like, I couldn't have made that happen if I had tried. You know, something we say in recovery, God does for me what I cannot do for myself when I surrender my life and my will. Very difficult for me, and I've had to do that in layers, surrendering, because I have a deep, deep sense of fear that if I don't control it, if I don't take care of it, it's not going to happen. Disaster is going to come, and it never does. Like, I've had some periods that were rough, living in places that didn't feel safe, having to drive a stick shift, which, whew, you don't want to drive with me with a stick shift, temporarily, so that I could afford childcare, things like that. Like, I've made a lot of sacrifices to get myself and my son to a safe place, but I knew every step of the way God was going to have my back. And, you know, I stall 7 times on the way home every day, but whatever, it's fine. I don't have to drive a stick shift anymore. Thank you, God. But I guess, like, the, you know, the gist of my story, I don't know if I emphasize this enough, but how dead inside I was for most of my life, and I didn't even know it. I just thought that was normal life, and how alive I feel today. And it's not like I have, like, tons of money or a loving relationship. Like, I'm, you know, I'm still single, I still don't own a home, but, like, my life is just filled with everything I need and then some. Like, the abundance is insane. The gifts that I'm given when I surrender, it's unbelievable. I feel actual joy and gratitude in my heart, which was a challenge for me for many years. I could say things I was grateful for, but I actually can feel it now. And I feel free, you know, I feel free from the shame and from the self-judgment and being worried about the judgment of others and things like that. And I'm learning to set big boundaries today, which is very hard for a codependent, but it's happening. And I'm doing things I just never thought I was would be able to do, and I'm happier than I've ever been. And it is because of Jesus Christ and because of his love and the way he taught me to love others and to love myself. So I pray for you that if you don't have that or if you don't feel that today, that it comes for you. And I would suggest you watch, if you can, Hosanna Wong, I Have a New Name, and The Chosen, because them along with this church and my recovery program definitely saved my life. I should mention, too, you know, I talked about in the beginning wanting to be loved and belong, and, like, I have that now. It's been, like, freely given to me, you know, in this church and in my recovery community. I don't long for, like, it would be nice to meet someone and have a partner, but I don't need that anymore. Like, I don't need that. I don't need all the stuff and, like, spending money. I don't need alcohol. I can be with myself and with God, and that's a huge gift. So I pray for all of you that you find that as well, and thanks for your time.
Great job. That was absolutely amazing. You know, we say it so many times, but don't tell me what God can't do, because we've seen what God can do. And every single one of us has a testimony. And every single one of our testimonies is different for a reason, because we get to reach people that she reaches people I can't reach. Jacob reaches people I can't reach. I reach people that they can't reach. And that is the hand of God. That's us being a living and breathing part of what he is doing here on earth. We get to share our testimony because we all can relate to somebody that is far from God. And it's just so important. If you have not thought of it already, think of this. If somebody asks me, why are you a Christian? How do you answer? Give a 5-minute response on how you answer, because this is what he did for me. Because this is who I was, and now this is who I'm not. And that's what you tell people. But you got to practice it and rehearse it. So that way, when somebody actually asks you, you don't just be like, because I like church and I like the music. You know what I mean? You got to be able to say stuff that has something that grabs a hold of them, because God placed them in your path. Just like with Adrienne, for her to be able to stand up here and be bold enough to talk to all of us, that's tough. Believe me, I do it for a living. It's tough stuff. And I'm happy that you did. Thankful that you did. Let's pray, and then we get it. Oh, I got to do tithing. Whoops, just kidding. I'm doing the offering. Am I doing the offering? Who's doing the offering? Who? Then get up here, Gabe. What the heck, bro? All right. Here you go, Gabe.
Gracias, señor.
Yes.
Good morning, church. Woo! Awesome, awesome testimony. Thank you for being bold. That was incredible, super incredible. In a moment, we're going to be taking up this morning's tithe and offering. But first, let's open up to the Word of God. The book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verse 9 through 10. The human author of the book of Proverbs, King Solomon, was one of the most honored men to ever walk this earth. The Lord granted him superior wisdom and knowledge. And from that came sincere honor and respect. From all who had heard of him throughout the Middle East, historians say that the Queen of Sheba, who brought King Solomon an abundance of gold, spices, and fine jewels, traveled 1,500 miles just to ask him questions and to visit with him. Solomon knew a thing or two about honor, and knowing that, we see that he wrote this: honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of your increase, so your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. We see here that giving to the Lord is an act of honor. It is a way of thanking God for all that he has provided in our lives. He supplies all our needs by his riches and glory, by Christ Jesus. And the least we can do is honor him with the first fruits of our increase. But that is not the end of the verse. The Lord says, so your barns will be filled with plenty, and your vats will overflow with new wine. What an amazing thing if you honor God with your finances and stay faithful to him. He will bless you financially until your vats overflow. So let's honor God this morning and give into his kingdom. Now I'd like to say a prayer. Please close your eyes and bow your heads. Heavenly Father, thank you that you can satisfy our every desire and need. Your word says that we should give honor to you with the first fruits of our wealth. Accept our tithes and offerings as a gift of worship to you. Multiply what we give for the effective growth of the kingdom. May Christ dwell in our hearts through faith so that we, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. May we be filled with all the fullness of God through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And I pray, amen.
Amen. How good was that testimony, huh? Man, I miss driving some stick shift, man. I'm jealous, Adrienne. One day. All right. Let us stand up and thank God for this morning. Amen?
A place to hide this weary soul, this backbone. And I try with all my might, but I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a vagabond. Cause he healed my heart.
burning like ashes in the wind. So, so long to my old friend.
Who are they?
Burning in bitterness. You can just keep it moving.
Come on, declare.
Nah, you ain't welcome here. From now till I walk the streets of gold, I sing of how you saved my soul. This wayward son has found his way back.
Jesus, thank you so much for just giving us another amazing day here in your house. Lord God, thank you for just choosing us to be able to just love you, Lord. Lord Jesus, we thank you and we bless you and we are just so grateful for you. It's in your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen. Guys, go in peace. and enjoy the rest of the weekend. Enjoy the rest of the week. Apply what you learned. Remember about the testimonies. Think it through and go Patriots. You guys are dismissed.